can't fathom why that would be. Let's go, horses. I don't hear myself. Let's go, horses. Do you hear me? You can't possibly hear me. How do you hear me? One, two. Oh. Talk again. No, I don't hear you. Well, that's good.
Oh. How about now?
I do.
I switched the Sirius's mic on.
Hey, and they fixed the... Hey, good job.
No, it's like...
Oh.
So you guys are over-modulated craziness. Is there a volume button you could turn down for...
So we don't have video? Are we aware of that? We don't have video. Are we aware of that? The other monitor says no signal.
The good monitor says no signal.
This is QFS Transportation Friday Night Rivals, driven by Cruise Chevrolet on MyTV Charleston.
And we welcome you to Philip Simmons here just off Clemens Ferry Road for QFS Transportation Friday Night Rivals, driven by Cruise Chevrolet. By record, you might think this is a mismatch. Two teams that are far more evenly matched than the records would say. A Bishop England team that's 3-0 all-time against Philip Simmons. Welcome in Darren Goldwater and my friend, the main anchor of ABC News 4, Dean Stevens. One day, Dean, this could be a rivalry. In order for that to happen, Philip Simmons has to start winning some of these football games.
I think people on both sides of the stadium tonight, here on the home side of Philip Simmons, on the other side of Bishop England, they would tell you that this is a rivalry game. These kids grew up playing football together. A lot of the BE kids, if they didn't go there, they'd be going to school here. They know each other. And let's say for tonight they don't like each other.
There have been a lot of issues for the battling bishops this year. Everything off the field that we're all going through, and then what's on the field as well. What has been consistent, Weston Peterson, the captain, carrying the football.
Well, they've got quarterback problems. Their top two quarterbacks injured last week. So tonight they're going to depend on number two, Peterson. He's got 41 carries, 149 yards. That's about 3 yards per carry. They're going to need to grind this game out. Because when you start taking a look at the other side of the ball, Isaac Shemp, number 34, he's rushed for 288 yards in the Iron Horses' first three games, carrying about 7.5 yards per carry. 2 touchdowns for the young man. Should be a great game.
Philip Simmons is in its fourth year of playing football. They've never won more than 3 games in a season. They're 3-0. They've got history in front of them, the Iron Horses and the Battling Bishops on QFS Transportation Friday Night Rivals, driven by Cruise Chevrolet. Okay, so, Nick, I don't want to tell you not to talk to us, but you might kill me. Yeah. Okay. The Iron Horses trying to make history in the fourth season of the program, an opportunity to win their fourth game, something they've not done. They've outscored their opponents this year 111-14, and a Bishop England team that has one offensive touchdown. Throw those numbers out, because these teams on the field, both coaches are going to tell you, both coaches told me, on the field they're evenly matched. It was a 14-7 game last year. And Dean, I don't know about you, it's something I'm expecting again. It's also a sloppy track, very sloppy.
Looks great on TV, looks perfect on TV. If you look down in the left corner of the end zone, as you see it on the screen, you can see tire tracks. But you walk out onto the field and it is thick with mud. It'll be good for a running game, bad for the passing game.
Chase Daniel's going to take this thing from the goal line, and Daniel is smothered right about the 20-yard line. So Bishop England will begin from about the 20-yard line, and we will get to introduce you to Riley Finlayson. He told me before the game, after Coach Canty told me that there was a quarterback competition prior to last week's game against James Island because of a slew of injuries. Coach Canty said, we went to Finlayson, a usual wide receiver. He came in from somewhere else. He came here from Utah,
right,
to South Carolina, and is now the starting quarterback for the Battling Bishops.
They need him to be clean tonight, as this running game as well.
Well, they're going to get about 10 yards on the opening play from scrimmage. There's Weston Peterson, who's averaging 3.5 yards a clip, and he picks up 10 to begin this game.
A lot of the focus tonight. We'll keep an eye on that offensive line, really from both sides. I mean, we talk all the time, said every game, doesn't matter what level. These games are won in the trenches. Who handles the line of scrimmage best tonight is going to win this football game.
Finlayson pulls that one. He read the defense perfectly. Gets one on the edge here to Barnwell, and Barnwell picks up about 7.
Nice job by Finlayson to hold that ball until the last minute to pitch. Made the defender commit.
Now that Bishop England has Danny Krogan as its offensive coordinator, they wanted to throw the ball a bit more as Peterson is tripped up and stumbles forward for maybe a yard, and it'll bring up third down.
That is Dan Wojtek, one of the two leading scorers or leading tacklers for the Iron Horses. Tommy DeLegro looks like he hurt his leg down at about the 38-yard line.
Unfortunately, that's been part of the storyline for the Bishops. We told you about the quarterback situation. Marco Pampu injured against Ashley Ridge. The backup quarterback comes in against Ashley Ridge. And by the way, BE was very competitive in that game with a team that's now ranked at a higher level. And the backup quarterback gets hurt as well. So now they're down to Finlayson, who so far, as Dean pointed out, he's got to be clean. He has been clean. But the junior in the middle of that offensive line, a very young offensive line, DeLegro needs to be helped up.
He's braced up on the right knee, having trouble putting weight on the left knee. You know, and I think if you've been around Coach Canty at all, as we have through the years, I think if it was 100 degrees outside with a field temperature of about 119, the man wouldn't sweat. He is cool. He is calm. And that's exactly what you need right now when your team struggles out to an 0-3 start. 8 of their last 10 seasons have been had. They've had winning records. This is uncommon territory. But watch them fight.
Finlayson on the keep. And Finlayson is helped forward and does have the first down. The tackle there by Abram Wright, number 58, a 270-pound senior in the middle of the defensive line.
BE opened the season with a 20-0 loss to Porter Gad, lost to Ashley Ridge 20-3, and then 23-16 to James Island.
That was the only start of Finlayson's career at quarterback last week. Here's Peterson now, and Peterson rumbles through the first wave and blows away the second wave. Weston Peterson, 59 yards. And the Bishops find the end zone first, a Trident Technical College touchdown. Your future, your college.
Statement made by the Battling Bishops. Again, one offensive touchdown in their first three games. One series here at Philip Simmons, and they equal their season total.
I was about to say that with Danny Crogan now back after playing in the Charleston Southern system under Jamie Chadwell, the system that Coastal Carolina is now running, if you're familiar with that, they want to throw the ball more than a typical BE team has. But that's not the way it's going to be, as the extra point is deflected, so that's short. There's a flag down as well. But five running plays, nets them 80 yards. The final 59 coming from Weston Peterson.
Go back a week ago, right? What did the coaches at Fort Dorchester and Dorman tell you before that game? As much as they were going to throw the ball, we were going to be there a while, and we were. We may be home by 8:25 tonight.
And we were. The drive only took less than, 2 minutes off the clock?
Well, it's going to do one of two things. It's going to wake up this Philip Simmons team. It's also going to jack up this Bishop England defense. And again, Ashley Ridge, a ranked team in the state.
Mm-hmm.
And they give up just 20 points.
Bishop England led them 3-0 midway through the third quarter. And that was after losing Pampu, the starting quarterback. Against James Island, they scored in the fourth to make it 17-16. Canty said they were just struggling to move the ball, so he went for two. And then there was a late score that made the game 23-16 in favor of James Island. A team that's better than its record, under the direction of a guy who's won a couple of state championships. And he told me, we're just trying to get better every day, man. He said, it's not typical. Sometimes you're not on the field. Here's Riley Beard weaving his way with a flag down on the far side 40. And Beard gets across midfield, but we'll have to check on that flag.
Talked about the moisture on that turf. Riley didn't care. He planted that right foot, made a move, created a seam, and then busted it up the middle to the BE 49-yard line. The flag back on the Philip Simmons side of the field. And that's exactly where the ball is going to go back to. They'll spot it at the 38. And they're going to step off 15. Make it 10.
So it takes off 20, about 3 yards from the return. The flag was at the 38, as Dean pointed out.
Hard to see in the replay exactly what the call was or who initiated the foul.
Here's one thing that has been consistent. Tripp Williams, he's a senior. He was slated to be a four-year starter, but a couple of injuries as a freshman and a sophomore derailed that. So second straight year starting, and he begins giving it to Isaac Schimpf for a couple of yards.
Schimpf is a young man. They've got a running back by committee, three guys in that committee. Isaac's going to get most of the carries tonight. But Markellis Asbury's also, he's got 24 carries. But you'll see him rolling in and out. This Tripp Williams kid, though, something special.
Physical runner, too, when he wants to be. Up to make the hit is Andrew Taws after about an 8-yard run and a first down. Back-to-back carries for Schimpf moves the chains.
Keep running the ball. You keep running until they can stop you.
I asked Coach Bendig about the lopsided stats, the amount of carries and yards on the ground versus that through the air, and it's been a product of their games and their scores. 111 points scored, 14 allowed. They come on the reverse here with Troy Stevenson, and Stevenson breaks one free to the outside, and a flag comes in as he's wrangled out of bounds.
You got to give a lot of props to number 54, Hunter Ramey. You know, the big uglies don't get much attention in these games, but when you turn the corner and you peel off a block like Ramey just did, you get your name called and your number.
Ramey's the best offensive lineman they've got. He goes both ways because Eric Bendig can't keep him off the field defensively. He says he doesn't want to play these guys both ways. But when you got a guy like Hunter Ramey, whose brother's at the Citadel and who's taking an official visit himself, an unofficial, I should say, to Clemson this weekend, you put him on the field.
Absolutely. Leads the defense in tackles with Wojciech.
So we have yet to see a ball put in the air, but this game has not been lacking for offense as flags come in here. Game opened on the fifth play from scrimmage with a 59-yard touchdown run from Peterson. That's got the score as you're looking at it here, 6-0. Procedural penalty on Philip Simmons. It'll be a false start, so that puts him back at the 32.
I think that's going to be the only thing that's going to slow down these two running attacks right now. Yellow flag.
pounder. That's what Trip Williams is, and that's the weight behind those pads as he picks up almost what was lost on the false start.
They like something they've seen in the middle of that line between the guards, not even outside between the tackles.
Bishop England runs a 3-4, so if you're running that, the guy at the nose, his job is to clog that up. Their starter at nose, Stan Sembos, is out tonight. Coming back the other way.
Great
this
pursuit.
This is Quay Green's Doom Dennis. Last week he surprised some folks. He was wearing 22. He's in 81. Matching the roster, Doom Dennis with the stop. He's a baseball player.
I think with a name like Doom, you could probably anything. I mean, baseball, yes. Football, absolutely works. Track, most likely.
Anything where you can impact the opponent. So maybe not track. You're not hitting someone. You can't lay the doom.
I don't know if you're throwing a shot put, though, maybe.
Okay. I'll give you that.
Watch the arm.
Williams, as he rolls away from his strong side, tosses one incomplete. And we get a look at our Cruise Chevrolet keys to the game from Dean Stevens.
Well, I think you've seen it for both sides. Who's going to control the line of scrimmage? First series, it was the BE offensive line. For Philip Simmons, you just see their first pass of the game. They want to control it when they've got the ball and minimize turnovers. Much like last week, we saw Fort Dorchester Dorman. Dorman turned it over, key spot in third quarter. Fort Dorchester steamroll from there.
It is fourth down and 13. Iron Horses go for it against a three-man rush and a jump ball down the sideline.
That's going to
be a flag.
Going to be an offensive pass interference.
Notice no touchdown signal was given, only the flag is down. It was Tristan Skipper who made the grab.
It looks like a sold-out crowd over here. On this side, one of the better crowds we've seen on a Friday Night Rivals game. They did not appreciate the call at all.
Tough to stomach when you get a touchdown taken back on a 4th-and-13 heave from the 30.
You saw the arm strength of the young man. Also put some air underneath it.
So another crack at fourth down for the Iron Horses. Williams.
I think BE, they get the ball here. You need to put a call into your, I think Bendig is out at about the 22-yard line right now trying to figure out why. I don't think he's, yeah, here comes the offense. Offense comes back. No, it's not. It's a defense.
It is. You just got confused because you got a couple guys who are playing both ways. So they'll turn it over on downs. Peterson had a 59-yarder to open up the scoring, the only score to this point, and he fights his way for a few yards.
I think at this pace, Peterson is going to eclipse his season total of 149 in this game if they keep feeding it to him.
Put another 50-yarder in the books, and he's right there. This is going to be Peterson once again, but he is upended in the backfield. That was Dan Wojcik. Wojcik used to be on the offensive line, and then he went from 230 down to what he's listed, 175.
Say again.
Yeah. Goals, right?
Goals. you got my attention when you said 230. You had me at 230. And I'm not talking about going to the dentist either. My 230.
Here's third and six. Finlayson puts it up for the first time, and he had a man, but he let him out of bounds. The diving attempt from Barnwell will be incomplete.
Love the play call. Love the launch of Finlayson. Just outside of lines. Just outside of the reach of Oliver Barnwell's feet. Hands, no problem.
Here's William Poole to punt. You know, despite the injury issues for Bishop England, their numbers are strong. They've got about 50 on the varsity roster, about 50 on the JV roster. This tumbling one here from Poole is attempted to be picked up, and a mistake from the Iron Horses will give the ball to B.E. A critical mistake from Riley Beard to even think about that. And B.E. with a six-point lead has it at the 25.
That ball was not going anywhere. Nothing else needs to be said to the young man because Coach Bendig took care of that from about the 35 to the 45-yard line. That's why coaches go gray so early in life. We saw Beard make a nice return on the last punt that came back. He'll have an impact on this game later.
The leading receiver on their team. Finlayson, back-to-back plays in the air. That is too tall for Chase Daniel.
I'm going to tell you something. Put a little zip on that thing. Just sword on him.
You know, you can go, you got to work if you want to find some video prep for high school games. But on Max Preps, you sometimes can see some video. And there was some video of the James Island game for BE. And Finlayson whipped it around. He was 5-7 last week. Here's second down and 10. This one a little bit back to the traditional style. It's Peterson, and he's inside the 10. It's first and goal for the Battling Bishops. A Miller Mott College first down, proudly supporting the Lowcountry's high school sports.
Peterson was able to get it to the outside, and instead of making a move trying to shake off a defender, he just turned his pad square to the goal line and took off. Great acceleration. Comes out for a breather. Barnwell in the backfield now.
First down and goal. Finlayson fakes the pitch and darts towards the end zone. Two offensive touchdowns for the Bishops in one quarter. That doubles their production from their first three games, and they lead it 12-0.
They have absolutely flipped the script. right? We prepped this game. You get ready for this game, and you see the stats. And you're thinking 0-3 versus 3-0, okay. Well, one team's scored 111 points already in three games. The other one scored just one touchdown. It would totally make sense that Philip Simmons would blow them out of the stadium. But let's flip the script.
As I told you, expect a better matchup than the records would indicate.
Yes.
Bishop England's going to go for two. That's a busted play. Can Finlayson make something of it? And no, he runs into that Iron Horse wall. Connor White, the senior safety, prevents the two-point conversion. And we got a 12-0 lead for the road team. The Bishops on QFS Transportation Friday Night Rivals, driven by Cruise Chevrolet. If teams are evenly matched, oftentimes turnovers are going to dictate the storyline of the game. A fumbled punt at the 25-yard line prevents an Iron Horse possession. A few plays later, Bishop England takes it in, Riley Finlayson, and it's two touchdowns on the board for the battling Bishops with 5:18 to go in the opening quarter. Remember, Philip Simmons drove down and converted until a penalty wiped it off, a fourth down for a touchdown. There's been a lot of action here in 6 minutes and change.
Indeed. Couldn't think of a better night for football. From the get-go.
It's interesting. The area got a ton of rain yesterday.
Yep.
That system that formed in the Gulf and then skirted off our coast.
I believe we called it Mindy.
Okay, Mindy. And
it was the remnants of Mindy.
Well, the remnants of Mindy are all here. They are on this field, every last remnant of Mindy. And it looks great right now, but just wait till the end of the game. I can tell you, walking on the field an hour and a half before the game, immediately I said, this is soaked.
Most fields have a little dome to them where it kind of fall off on both sides. You see in the middle of the field, looks a bit better, but if you go down the top left, the BE side, you see it churned up pretty good. Let's keep an eye if that's Riley Beard in the back. Would like to atone for that misjudgment that led to the last score.
He'll get a chance, and he'll do so with another ball that he has to pick up off the ground from the 15-yard line. And he'll get about 15 more yards. Philip Simmons' second offensive possession will start from their 30.
I don't know if you noticed, but boy, right when he started to get into some BE defenders, he doubled up, covered up that ball nice and tight.
Philip Simmons opened the year shutting out Georgetown. Walkamall, 36-14 was the next victim. Then Military Magnet last week, 46-0. They have a dual threat guy in Trip Williams and a lot of different guys who can carry the ball effectively. We've seen Isaac Schimpf already. We've seen two receivers get it on a reverse. And now we see KJ Asbury, and Asbury lowers his shoulder into Adam Giovi. It's about a 3-yard run.
Defensive line, linebacker pursued it to the outside, and it gave Giovi time to come up and make the open field stop after just 3 yards. But that's the second running back we're going to see from tonight.
Eric Bendick told me that in the offseason, it was Asbury and Sherrod Williams, who we haven't seen yet.
Mm-hmm.
He thought those were the two guys who were battling it out. Here's Williams, and Williams pushes forward, gets through Giovi, then lost the football. The extra effort leads to the ball popping out.
B.E. was the first on the scene.
Remember, they just got a fumble at the Philip Simmons 25. And they got another one. And about 15 yards farther upfield.
Both turnovers in Philip Simmons territory. Williams picked up the initial 5 or 6, and then he started running into white jerseys, plowed ahead for a couple of more yards, and that's when things got dicey, and that's when the ball came popping out. A couple of bishops, Johnny on the spot.
There was a part of me coming to this game thinking, in some ways, even though Philip Simmons is now ranked number 9 at the 2A level,
yep,
and Bishop England's 0-3, in some ways, this could be bigger for Philip Simmons. I'll explain here as Peterson is wrapped up. The logic is they're in their fourth year playing football. They've never beaten Bishop England. Their head coach, Eric Bendick, said it himself. We'd like this to be a rivalry, but if that's going to happen, we need to win some of these games. And they've never had 4 wins. So I'm thinking you've got an 0-3 team. You've got an opportunity to clear a couple hurdles. And they're down 2 scores. Second down and 10. Finlayson to the air. A juggling grab is made by Charlie Rainey. A first down to the 25. Give him 16 yards.
Well, that was fairly impressive on a couple of different levels. For Finlayson to find him across the seam, to deliver the ball a little high, and then Rainey helps him out by pulling it in with one hand. But back to Philip Simmons, anytime you start a brand new, open up a brand new school and you start the varsity level like they did.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they lost 32-16 the first year to BE, 27-14, and then 14-7 last year.
That ball's on the ground. Peterson covers it up. Did so right before Spignardo got there. It's the first negative yards play for Bishop England. And they've had the ball for the majority of this first quarter. One Philip Simmons drive. Pushed down to about the 25-yard line. Turned it over on downs. Second down and 20 here. He came in from Utah. He fires a bullet to Charlie Rainey. Needs 4 guys just to take him down. He wouldn't go the easy route and get out of bounds. Manageable 3rd down coming up.
We talked earlier about the offensive lineman for Philip Simmons had the nice block. Same's got to go for number 6, Chase Daniel of Bishop England. Threw his body into a block. Allowed him to spring it for another 4 or 5 yards.
They need 4. It won't be Peterson. That could be a face mask, and there's the flag. Finlayson will pick up the 1st down without the flag. Tack that on, and it'll be 1st and goal. Another Miller Mott College 1st down, proudly supporting the Low Country's high school sports. Defense! Defense!
Defense! I got to think at some point here, Bishop England ends up scoring. And you put together everything in a big box and take a look at 2 turnovers. Take a look at a couple of face mask calls. at some point, Eric Bending's going to call a timeout. And he's going to take him to church right out there on the field in a big circle because they need a reset, and they need a reset quick.
They'll have that reset opportunity in about 2 minutes. 2:09 left in an opening quarter that has been dominated by Bishop England. First and goal, Finlayson. Low pitch, scooped up by Philip Simmons. Just what the doctor ordered for the Iron Horse. Tristan Skipper the other way. No flags. A touchdown for the Iron Horse.
Skip, skip. Skip to my Lou. He doesn't need to have a come to meet Jesus meeting. Skipper said, hold on. Picked it off clean off the turf. A little bunny hop into his hands. That was a 75-yard sprint.
All right. So two turnovers give Bishop England the ball in scoring position. They get one score and give one score. And this game has a completely different feel to it as Griffin Gore, 6'5", kicker. I don't know how height helps kicking.
And by the way, I talked to a Philip Simmons coach. He had a different number than I did. They lead the state in turnovers. The turnover belt going to Skipper. And I believe that's 17 on the year. Before the game, I thought 12 or 13, but he said 16. I wasn't going to argue with him because he was holding the turnover belt.
I saw that belt get walked out onto the field. I walked right past that belt and wanted to ask if I could hold it, but I didn't even ask. I felt like I didn't deserve to hold the turnover belt.
The pitch just came up short. Boy, just hopped up.
Look at him go.
It's pretty good sprints. I think we did this a year ago. Just how fast was he?
That was C.J. Stokes, right?
That was C.J. Stokes.
We timed C.J. Stokes, who's the Hammond running back, committed to Michigan. We tried to. I say we timed. We tried. Brand new ball game, 12-7. I certainly did not anticipate 19 first quarter points between these two.
I didn't anticipate three turnovers.
No.
In the first quarter either.
A line drive shot from Gore. From just outside the goal line, Bishop England will get out across the 20.
And that was Sherrod Williams. We were talking about him as a running back. He came down and he was untouched. Pursued the ball. Made a nice open field tackle.
I'm unofficially tracking plays. I'm in the ballpark of about 8 offensive plays for Philip Simmons in this quarter.
Total.
Yes.
And Bishop England?
Significantly more. I won't effort that because, like I said, these are not exact
these are
numbers.
Unscientific numbers.
No. First carry of the game here for someone other than Peterson. It's Dixon Hardy. A sophomore, his head coach, John Canty, called a grinder. He grinds for a loss of 2.
Tristan Skipper woke up the Iron Horses. An Iron Horse sharpens an Iron Horse.
Sharp teeth.
It's been a while since I've seen momentum turn that quickly.
It feels completely different, doesn't it?
Yep.
A flag in. It woke this crowd up.
And it woke the crowd up.
And a false start on BE. So I pointed out on their last possession, it was one of their first negative plays all day. Then you give up a fumble return for a touchdown. You get popped on the return, lose yards, and then a false start. So it's possible that the fumble return has shaken Bishop England a little bit.
I think you go from playing free and easy to maybe being a bit more cautious.
They let the pressure come to set up the blitz and the dump off on the screen. Dixon Hardy. There's a flag down.
Going to be a block in the back.
So it'll be a hold.
They had one man to beat there. And they couldn't do it because of the holding call. You know, we talked about Philip Simmons' first 3 years. You know, there's also games there that they'll never forget, right?
Mm-hmm.
He lost to Timberland 58-0 in the first year. Oceanside 55-0. They took their lumps and then some.
Finlayson pulls, and he's got the edge, bumped out of bounds. That was Hunter Ramey. About 18 seconds left in this opening quarter. Three turnovers, two of them fumbles from Philip Simmons. It led to one Bishop England score. Then a Bishop England fumble led to a 75-yard unofficial scoop and score from Tristan Skipper. It's Peterson on third and long here. And Peterson finds some running room and comes within a yard of a first down.
They had trips to the lower side of your screen. And those three receivers did a nice job of blocking. And then a nice job by Connor White to stick his nose in there to make the tackle a yard or two short.
Fourth down coming up to begin the second quarter on QFS Transportation. Friday Night Rivals, driven by Cruise Chevrolet.
You can adjust volume right here. Are we going to our sideline, girl?
12-7, our score, as we start the second quarter here. The stop from Connor White prevented what would have been a first down run on 3rd and 16. And the Bishops have their offense out deep in their own end for 4th and 2 now.
You're 0-3, and you're coming into a rivalry game. Why not?
Peterson lowers down, and it'll depend on the spot.
Which foot?
Yes.
If it's a right foot, he's got it. If it's a left foot, I think he's short.
I'll give you a guess. I'm not even going to guess. That's how close I think this is. The question for Greg Glasgow and his crew I guess, do you call it or bring out the chains? There's not a flag down.
I think they're going to bring the chain out. Yes. A Philip Simmons player on the ground giving it an eyeball to the grass level look.
Yeah, that's how close it is. Oh, Glasgow wants to signal first down.
I think they had marked it wrong at the 15 where the...
So by the sticks, that's a first down. Yes, okay. There's a lot of hesitation about bringing out the sticks and figuring out that the ball was ahead of him. So the gamble pays off. Under John Canty, he's in his 14th year. He's got almost 100 more wins than he does losses. Dixon Hardy, speaking of losses, takes one right there.
That's Hunter Ramey again. I think his brother's down the sideline at the Citadel.
Mm-hmm.
But he's had his nose in quite a few plays tonight.
Best offensive lineman they've got. You can make a case he's their most impactful defender. The converted receiver, Finn Layson, plays the option very well. Gets one to Dixon Hardy, and Hardy's legs are wrapped up there on the sideline. That was Hunter Ramey again. Now, I told you he's taking an unofficial visit to Clemson. He wants to be a long snapper. He wants to have a preferred walk-on. And he had a conversation with Tony Elliott this week, so he's on the radar screen at Clemson.
Keep an eye on Finn Layson. He was high load. Got up very gingerly, which this team cannot afford to lose. Take my punter, take my kicker, do not take my quarterback.
Here's Peterson now, puts his foot in the mud and darts one upfield for a first down. He was down before the ball came out. It'll move the chains.
Talk about downfield vision. He made a couple of really nice cuts to avoid contact, not once, but twice.
An A&I Fire and Water Restoration first down, making your house home again after disaster strikes.
He's averaged just around 3 yards a carry coming into this game through the first three games. And I'd have told you it was six or seven.
Finlayson wisely holds on to that.
By the way, that was extremely wisely.
Ryan's like, ropes.
You know, because on the fumble, that was just a pitch that came up a little short.
Uh-huh.
I think he thought about it when he first was spun around. But you'd rather eat it, try to get your yards back in the next two plays.
Ryan Propes made the stop. If you're wondering, it is as hard in person as it is on the screen to identify dark purple numbers on black jerseys.
I think the back is easier than the front.
Speaking of front, that's a forward pass. And it'll be third down and 18. You know, you mentioned the last thing you wanted have happened is an injury to a quarterback.
Yep.
I asked John Canty today.
What was his answer?
No, I said, how about who's returning kicks for you? Because you didn't list that in the depth chart. He said, oh. I shouldn't have Finn Layson back there because I can't. he said, just keep an eye on it when we get out there.
Yep.
So that was part of the early season.
And you can see why.
Finn Layson on the move, throws it right to Hunter Ramey. Ramey breaks a couple of tackles and slips through another. Oh. Ramey falls down. The turf got him inside the 10. Nearly another defensive touchdown for the Iron Horses. It'll be first and goal.
Yeah, his brother, I would imagine. That's his brother about the 20-yard line in the cadet outfit. Wants to give him a hug, but he's staying on to block now.
Oh. He had it, too. He got through all the traffic and then just lost his balance.
So I had them coming at 13. I think the coach told me 16. So now they're up to 18.
Can the Iron Horses capitalize? First down and goal, there are whistles.
Bending wants a timeout. I think he only had 10 on the field. Yep, he only had 10 on the field.
I could be mistaken, but I thought that was 24 who carried it, which would be Jonathan Cheek.
On the pick?
On the carry right there, that didn't count. QFS Transportation is proud to present each participating homeschool a check for $500. This grant provides each school with extra funding to help make their school great. Over the past 11 seasons, Friday Night Rivals and our sponsors have donated over $120,000 to Lowcountry students and schools. Congratulations from MyTV Charleston, ABC News 4, and QFS Transportation. Eric Bendig, a Wando grad, played at Presbyterian. And the first player from his program here to play in college is also at PC. So this is first and goal, and down to about the 2. That's Isaac Schimpf.
They've not called his name since the first quarter. Helmet comes off. He comes off.
It's because they haven't had the ball.
They had it for 8 plays.
Second down and goal. Trip Williams pushes the pile. A touchdown for the Iron Horses. And Philip Simmons takes the lead from 12-0 down to a point on top. A Trident Technical College touchdown. Your future, your college.
First it was Skipper and then Tripper. Turnovers were equal. Touchdowns were equal. Where they had the advantage is extra points.
BE had their first one blocked. They went for 2 on their second. And the 6'5 junior, I still can't get over the fact you got a kicker who's 6'5 and he's nailing them through the uprights. Let's introduce you to the third member of our crew, Amy Russo.
All right, and you guys, I am here with Principal Chris Kupolt of Philip Simmons High School. You know, Principal, kind of tell us, you know, what are some things that the Iron Horses are looking forward to this school year?
We're looking forward to just getting back to normal. And if you look around, it looks like we're getting there. We're just excited. We're fortunate to be playing this game right now. We're probably one of the few teams in the Lowcountry that actually played all of its games and against the opponents we were supposed to play on the schedule. So we're fortunate. We're looking forward that hopefully this keeps up.
Yeah, absolutely. And I was going to say, just kind of looking at that crowd of students and everybody there supporting the Iron Horses tonight, how great does that feel after last year?
We love this. You know, we had limited capacity last year. This year we are getting, like I said, back to normal. And I think this is one of the underrated rivalries around. And you can see it out here tonight. I mean, it's a fun time. So we're excited.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Principal. We'll go ahead and send it back to you, Dean and Darren.
Thank you, Trooper Amy. Good work, kid.
You know, so he calls it the rivalry.
Yeah.
They're maybe 15 minutes apart, maybe, depending on traffic.
I think they
on
said
Clemens
5 miles down, 5 miles down the road. Right?
It's... I've lived up here now for, I don't know, 15 years or so in the area. And I always thought a high school on Daniel Island, or Clements Ferry, that's something that was needed. And now that you've got it, you've got the option, if you're a family, you've got the private school option and the public school. You could see both of these growing alongside of each other a little bit here.
Right. And the crazy part was, it was kind of a cool moment before kickoff. Share that story with you after this.
Here's Barnwell. He waits for the blocks to set up in front of him. Then he knifes his way through and gets knocked over by his own guy shy of the 30-yard line.
Cole Carson Cole Carson now leading our hit of the night.
Sometimes patience pays off, and it did right there for Barnwell.
He did. And watch again. Sticks his foot in the ground, finds a hole, and finds Cole Carson.
He even extended the arms for good measure.
But they had the drum line walk in, and then they had the middle school out here, and also Daniel Island Elementary School, the kids there, and they all walked in, right? But that Daniel Island Elementary School is right down the street from BE.
Here's Peterson. Guess who stops him? Hunter Ramey is in on the stop. And Wojtek, two leaders on the inside. Unofficially, Ramey has every stop made by the Iron Horses tonight.
Puts him in rare air.
There was a collegiate player last week, I think had 30 tackles. Here's Peterson. It's a pretty nice fake there from Finlayson. It results in a first down. It stalled the middle of the defense just enough.
I'm going to tell you, not seeing highlights of this kid and just looking at the stats and being one of our focused players, I didn't know what to expect, but I'm not sure I expected this.
Yeah. There's a burst there.
He's a great runner.
Uh-huh.
Stays kind of low, doesn't run straight up. Would like to say he runs downhill, but that's exactly what he does.
And he can cut, right? There isn't wasted movement. One cut, lower the pads, another first down, although we've got a
flag
here.
I think that's going to go on the receiver.
Peterson asks out here. He can get a blow.
Bishop England played a pretty clean first half, first quarter. Second quarter been much different. The two turnovers, a couple of costly penalties, that this one being one of them certainly.
Each team has turned it over twice. Philip Simmons has a 75-yard scoop and score. They have an interception that put him inside the 10 and then scored again. Those are the last two scores of the game. Here's Dixon Hardy with Peterson out, and he is down. It'll be second down and 20.
I think that was Wojtek inside. But how big was that penalty? I mean, you go from second and short to first and 20. And deciding to run it on that play certainly puts you in a position now where you've got to throw the ball, don't you? His last throw intercepted.
All run here. Abram Wright, 58, wrapped him at the waist. It'll be third down and about 18.
Philip Simmons has survived that initial rush. And Bishop England owned the momentum of this game and the scoreboard.
And then you could feel it change on the fumble and scoop and score from Skipper.
Like that.
Yep. And since, Bishop England's offense hasn't gotten in gear either. Dixon Hardy ridden down to the ground.
I'm not sure if that's where they wanted that play to go by Hardy. Remember last time they had the three wide receivers together. That run went to the outside, and they kind of led the way as their own little blocking formation. Picked up 15 or so yards, if you remember back. I think it was their last series or two series ago. Now, I told you, Riley Beard's waiting to
Williams.
Atone for that mistake.
Wow. Look at this punt from Poole. Beard backpedaling, makes the first guy miss, and no is the answer to the question of did Poole outkick his coverage. There's a flag down on the opposite side of the field at about the 38.
I thought Beard was going to try to turn that corner. He'd have been in good shape. He crushed that ball. a nice job switching hands.
It's a 44-yard kick officially. It felt a lot longer than that.
Offsetting.
There were offsetting unsportsmanlike conduct penalties on the play.
It's a teaching going on the sidelines.
Six-two senior Trip Williams pulls it out of the belly of Asbury, and Williams, he's one of the bigger guys on the field at 220. So you lower that shoulder, and he moves guys about 6 yards.
I'm going to see if they... Williams just took his helmet off to get his hair out of his eyes. He's allowed to stay on the field. Is that a high school rule, or is that just a college rule? You take your helmet off.
I guess if it's to get hair out of your face. If it's cosmetic.
Yes.
This time, Asbury rips it away from Williams. And Doom Dennis is in on the stop with Michael Murphy.
I remember
third and two.
When Lou Holtz was at Carolina, I remember him saying that he told his players when they celebrated not to take their helmets off. He said, now, if they wanted to take their helmets off when they dropped a pass or fumbled a ball, that they were more than welcome to take their hats off and celebrate.
Third down and two for Williams and company under late pressure. A dangerous ball. Sails incomplete.
Doom came in to drop the boom on him. But did a nice job just altering the way he had to deliver that ball. Was not able to step into it. Bishop England, we saw them go for it on fourth and two. Philip Simmons now up two. With just about 4 minutes on the clock. And they're going to keep it right here. See if they get him to jump.
Momentum's on their side. They get the ball to begin the third quarter. On fourth down, they go through the middle with Schimpf, and I don't think so. Mm,
they did give it to him.
They gave him a wonderful spot.
Oh, geez. Did you see that? Chip Carlson almost decapitated the referee. My man Nick Case is going to find that highlight for us. Or what would have been a low light. He was celebrating the stop. Yeah, that was awesome.
I'm only
think
about
it was a favorable spot.
A favorable spot. I think it was a yard and a half, 2 yards.
That's a gift spot.
The line of scrimmage didn't move to the 40. Here's a whistle. Now they can't go review this.
It's
a flag. We're not far line of sight from being right on that 40. I mean, I'm pretty close to being at midfield.
Here you go.
Where, at yeah. No point did he get close to the 40-yard line.
No. Not at all.
But that's not what
but
matters.
But now interesting is the field judge, the sideline judge, also had the same spot as the guy up top.
Yeah.
But I think in that pile, I don't think he pushed the pile. The pile may have been to the 40, but the ball never made it to the 40.
Then they backed up. So it's first and 15. Off his back foot, Williams. That one's knocked away. Jack Huey in coverage. The intended target was Skipper, who's got a fumble return for a touchdown. The momentum-changing play of the game.
Yeah, great play by Huey. So many times we see the defensive back not turn around to find the location of the ball. But that time he did. Williams under pressure again. Skipper may have jumped a little too early, but that ball over his head.
Mm-hmm. Takes a little while to get out there. The completion good to Ben Dwyer Dreyer. Maybe the line of scrimmage.
Ball came loose. I saw three white jerseys around that thing. Is that Yui with the hit? Ball comes out. Been a weird flow to this game, truly.
A weird flow because there's been no flow. It's like the flow of a faucet that doesn't turn off. That's a long throw for Williams. And it'll bring up fourth down.
You go for it on fourth and two, do you go for it on fourth and five? And everybody's looking at Bendig wondering the same thing. He's not brought in. His punting team.
They need midfield.
He's still got 28 seconds on the clock. No, they're throwing. They're going to a play.
Oh yeah. They tried Stevenson there, one of two basketball guys. They'll use as wideouts, potential deep play threats, and they're going to be gifted the first down as Bishop England jumps. 2 minutes left in the opening half, and Philip Simmons is in business in BE territory.
I thought that was the play on their last fourth down. But they ran it. We'll have to ask Trooper Amy. He goes off the sidelines. Is that what they wanted? They wanted her to jump, or they were going to run a play there? Clock is running.
It was at about 2:02 when the penalty occurred. The question is, do the folks on the field know where the clock was? I can tell you it was at 2:02. I was watching it tick.
Until it didn't.
Yes, at 1:36. So almost 30 seconds ran off.
Yep, they've got it at 2:02.
This game felt like it was all Bishop England. When we talk about the flow and the lack of flow.
No, I said flow. You said there was no flow.
Right. So there was a little bit at the beginning.
There
was. And then that turnover happened, and the momentum switched, and then the penalties happened.
I thought we were going to be out of here by now.
Yeah, it's strange. There have been very few passes thrown in this game, yet the first half, in real time, is up over an hour already. It's a good job by the crew to get it back to 2 minutes and start it up here with the ball spotted. They've got the last 14 points in the game. Trip Williams wants more than that, and there's pass interference. He wanted Skipper once again. I think it was Giobi there in coverage who never turned around.
I think it was 11, Rainey maybe.
Okay.
He was running stride for stride with him. Just needed to turn. Right about the time where you put your hand up, turn your head around while you do it.
You're right, he was
because
Charlie
I think Rainey. I think if you make that move where you're turning to look at the ball, even if the guy, the receiver, stops behind you,
there are two flags. There's one at the line of scrimmage, and that's holding. So PI and holding will offset. And we'll replay first down from the time on the clock where we had before we put more time on the clock. Speaking of flow.
Oh, my goodness.
Hunter Ramey, one of the few mistakes, really the only one that was obvious. It wasn't only him.
Both teams have all three timeouts.
They could just keep racking up penalties to stop the clock, too.
turnovers are even. Feels like the penalties are about even as well. Our statistician caught in traffic hasn't made it to the ball park yet.
All things considered, it does feel very even with the turnovers, two apiece, with the penalties like you mentioned. You've got big plays on both sides. You have a 75-yard fumble recovery.
Yep.
You've got a 51-yard touchdown run for Bishop England.
Great play by Doom as well on that one. Get in the backfield.
Philip Simmons hoping to improve to 4-0. It would be the first time in their four-year history that they've picked up four wins in a season. And if they do it tonight, they've done it without a loss. Williams, straight drop back, complete over the middle. That's Ben Dreyer once again, down at the 40.
See if he wants a timeout. Not going to take it. He's got three. I don't know. Maybe you can cash him in at the concession stand on the way into the locker room. But I mean, he just lost 15 seconds off the clock.
Third down. That one looked like it slipped out of Williams' hands. It's a jump ball that almost slid into Troy Stevens' palms. But Stevenson couldn't haul it in with Jack Huey there.
Yeah, I agree with you 100%. He wanted that ball on a little bit of a line. He had Stevenson on a fly. That thing got caught up the second layer of the ozone. But a nice job by the DB to turn around and make a play for the ball.
Stevenson, a 6'1 sophomore. Had a couple of touchdowns through the air entering today. Two touchdowns on three catches. Here's fourth down again. They'll swing one out to Schimpf. All sorts of daylight for a first down, but not out of bounds to the 35. I wonder if the scoreboard is not incorrect and there are no timeouts.
I don't remember them taking any timeouts.
There was one when they had the ball in the goal-to-go situation prior to them scoring. He has taken another one here, Eric Bendig has. And we'll step aside as well. 14 seconds left in the opening half. QFS Transportation Friday Night Rivals driven by Cruise Chevrolet.
Trusted products and services are second to none. Please visit 360clean.com for more information and a free quote.
Eric Bendig's timeout leaves 14 seconds on the clock from the 35-yard line. And remember, Philip Simmons will get the ball to begin the third quarter. They've been much more stable since the fumble return for a touchdown from Tristan Skipper. Q Green's the wideout to the bottom of your screen. Williams never looks that way and throws high for Skipper.
Pass incomplete intended for Tristan Skipper. I'll bring up second down.
Here comes pressure from the backside. It blows him up. Mullen crushes him. It's incomplete at the goal line.
Pass calls incomplete, intended for Troy Stevenson on the play.
Jack Mullen had a couple extra words for Tripp Williams, too, as the two of them got up from the ground. It'll be third down with 1 second left. And the final timeout of the half now taken by Philip Simmons.
Timeout, Philip Simmons. That is their final timeout of the half.
I think it's pretty impressive for the Iron Horses. In their first 3 years of playing ball, they have a winning region record. They're 6-5 in region play. Made the playoffs.
And that was a step you want to take in year three, right? Finished second behind Woodland. Woodland's been really good for a long time. D1 talent rolls through there.
Yes. An opportunity for the Iron Horses to do a few things they've never done. Four wins, beat Bishop England. Final play of the first half. Williams launches for Stevenson, and it drifts over his outside shoulder. Check it, it was Q Green, 30-25. So a couple of shots come close, but fall incomplete around the goal line and in the end zone. Philip Simmons scores 14 unanswered after trailing 12-0 and leads Bishop England by a couple. At the half, your UFS Transportation Friday Night Rivals driven by Cruz Chevrolet. Fourth-year head coach Eric Bendig in search of his 12th win, guiding this up-and-coming program out here on Clements Ferry Road. And Bendig is with our Amy Russo.
We're getting set up on the field. Got to want to know what that momentum switch was like on that turnover, because it came quick and it came sudden, and then they were able to add another touchdown on top of it.
It was noticeable. If you can notice the momentum shift as it did from up here in the booth, the feeling down there on the sideline has to be even more so. He's with our Amy Russo.
All right, let's. Amy, if you can hear us, go ahead.
All right, obviously some technical difficulties down there with Amy and Coach Bendig. But I'll tell you, he's probably somewhat pleased. He's got a lead at the half over a team he's yet to beat, 14-12.
I mean, this man, he's got it. We're good? All right. So just point to me whenever. 30 seconds. We can do that. All right. So sorry, man.
Oh, you're right.
Eric Bendit.
We'll get it right. You might mess it up on the air.
There we go.
This looks good?
Love it.
All right.
Give me the shadow.
You know. Just kidding. All right, you guys, I'm standing here with Philip Simmons head coach Eric Bendit. I'm not going to be that good again in 5 seconds, man.
It was a great practice.
That's all right.
Ready?
Ready. Hey, you guys, I'm here with Philip Simmons head coach Eric Bendit. Coach, kind of a close first half. Kind of tell us, are you happy with that performance?
I'm not too happy with how we, controlled the football. We made a few mental mistakes, kind of killed ourselves on a few of those penalties. We had fumbles, dropped punts. So I'm happy that we executed enough to get 2 points into it. But we've got to play much better to win in the second half.
Yeah, and what are you implementing in the second half that didn't really happen in the first?
We got to do a better job of tackling. We got to do a better job of playing our keys. Offensively, we need to keep grinding it out, throw it up to a couple of our good athletes, make some of those passes convert, and just get out of this thing with a win.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Coach. I'll go ahead and send it back to you, Dean and Darren.
Thank you, Amy. Halftime report brought to you by Roper St. Francis Hospital, where experience matters. Each week, David Ayler Law Offices and Riders Law Group proud to highlight a scholar athlete from each participating school. Students selected have an opportunity to win a $5,000 scholarship at the end of the season. Here are your scholar athletes of the week. And we start with Elena McCoy, a 4.93 GPA. She plays softball and tennis. Meals on Wheels, she participates in Operation Christmas Child and also Walk for Life. Elena McCoy, your scholar athlete of the week from Bishop England. On the Philip Simmons side of things, you've seen his exploits on the football field. In the classroom, his GPA is over 5. He's a 4-year starter, couple-year captain. He's all-state in baseball. He's National Honor Society and junior marshal for school. That's the definition of a well-rounded student athlete right there, Tripp Williams. More on your Roper St. Francis Hospital halftime report when we bring you back. report brought to you by Roper St. Francis Hospital, where experience matters. The Rockstar Cheer of the Night gives you a chance to get interactive with us. Log on to abcnews4.com/poll and vote for either of tonight's cheer squads. Cast a vote in the Rockstar Cheer of the Night.
Go,
Philip Simmons family, we have some exciting news to share about a new restaurant that is opening up near the Publix Plaza that we pass every day on our way to school. Coach Kevin Mingo and his wife Krista, along with his...
All right, remember, you can log on abcnews4.com/poll. And remember, the visiting team typically wins. So if you're watching, you're a Philip Simmons fan, get on abcnews4.com/poll, and we'll give you results later on. You already saw the Scholar Athletes. Now let's hear from David Ehler himself with Scott Eisberg.
David Ehler joining us again, presenting our Scholar Athletes. So much fun each and every year to unveil them to you. The process is so cool each and every year. I know our last one during the pandemic was incredible. She even baked you a cake.
Yeah, she literally baked me a cake, and I ate it, of course. You know, just shows so many of the different talents that these students have. It's so much fun to be able to, you know, see everything they've accomplished when they submit at the beginning of the year and then watch their performances throughout the year. It's very rewarding.
Yeah, and this is not just football we're talking. We're talking about student athletes from every sport. And I think that's what kind of makes it fun, is you get to see a wide array of student athletes.
Right. You get to see students playing all different sports, having different interests within the classroom and then outside of the classroom with charities and nonprofits.
Yeah, that's always a fun thing. I know our last one heading to Clemson. Who knows where they will go this year? That's David Ehler from our Scholar Athlete Award presentation.
14-12 our score. Philip Simmons trying to knock off Bishop England for the first time in its 4 years. QFS Transportation, Friday Night Rivals, driven by Cruise Chevrolet. Halftime report brought to you by Roper St. Francis Hospital, where experience matters. Some of the shots, right, like you're seeing right here, are from what's called a scissor lift. And we'll get to that. First, we're going to talk about All-American Awards, because that trophy is one of my favorite things about the entire broadcast. It's the
because
mini Lombardi
why?
Trophy. It's a mini Lombardi trophy, and All-American Awards makes it. For almost 30 years, All-American Awards in Mount Pleasant has been your local trophy shop, providing both corporate and sports awards to meet your style and budget. Visit Steve and his crew, All-American Awards, when you recognize excellence. You can find them on the web, awardsguy.com. That's plural, awardsguy.com. Getting set for the second half. Iron Horses with 14 unanswered, set to get the ball on QFS Transportation Friday Night Rivals, driven by Cruise Chevrolet. Crowd's getting pretty animated here as we get set for the second half. The student section's been packed out here at Philip Simmons, and it's not like we're too far from Bishop England, so they've traveled over here well. They've got some student support. And as you can guess, our assumption is the two young men painted in green are not Philip Simmons fans, who are part of the antagonizing of some of the Philip Simmons fans.
I would suggest, if you decide to paint your body green and come over and jump into the Philip Simmons crowd, probably find a jersey over there if you want to. I will tell you this, we've got some scores we can pass along quickly. These are mainly halftime scores. So many games, five or six games canceled today because of COVID. Other teams just finding an opponent at the last minute. Goose Creek over Wilson, 42-13. First Baptist and Ben Lippin playing to a 14-14 tie at the half. Hanahan and Stratford all even at 7. Timberland up 20-6 on Lamar. Buford is beating West Ashley 21-7, and Kane Bay over James Island at the half. That score also 6-0.
Good reminder.
What you got?
With Buford on top, Buford has been added to our schedule. We, too, are in the mode of making sure we can broadcast games every week. Next week, our schedule has changed. Beaufort will be at Johnson Haygood Stadium to take on Oceanside Collegiate. That will be our QFS Transportation Friday night rivals game driven by Cruise Chevrolet next week from Johnson Haygood Stadium. Excited to see that. Oceanside is one of the best teams in the Lowcountry. Beaufort always puts a good product out on the field. Bishop England has put a good product out on the field for decades and has continued to do so under John Canty. And he is standing by with Amy Russo.
I don't know when they're going to take us. He's just going to point. I don't have my little earpiece in because it was too loud.
All right.
Having some issues communicating
down
there.
Down on the field. We should probably send Coach Candy over to the other side so he can get over and start coaching as they get ready to kick off.
Bishop England got the ball to begin the game. If you weren't with us at the beginning, they went five plays, 80 yards with a 59-yard touchdown run.
Look at the speed.
Here you go. You want to know how fast the 59-yard touchdown run? Wait, look in the right corner of your screen. Oh, he slowed down.
See? What'd I tell you? The guy never sweats.
It's the mud. He would have kept the pace up.
Yes.
Even though the field looks great, I'm telling you, you sink. You could see in my feet right now if you could actually see them. So opening drive looked great. Bishop England had one offensive touchdown all year, and bang, they strike for a 59-yard touchdown run.
Yeah.
The ensuing drive, Philip Simmons pushes down into Bishop England territory. Turn it over on downs after a fourth down completion in the end zone is wiped out with a penalty. After that, it became a turnover fest. Two for each side. Bishop England eventually went up 12-0. Philip Simmons then changed the tide with a 75-yard scoop and score from Skipper. Later got an interception from Hunter Ramey, which set him up for another score. 14 unanswered. Now they'll get the ball to begin the third quarter, and you are caught up.
Bishop England's first PAT was blocked at the line of scrimmage, just tipped a little bit. And then on their second touchdown, decided to go for two. Miscommunication in the backfield. Left Finlayson kind of standing there by himself with not really any room to go. So if we could readjust our keys to the game, and as you said, and you said it, you thought this was going to be an evenly matched game, and it has been. But I think the team, I know, call me brilliant. The team that plays a clean second half wins this game, right? And we got sloppy there late in the second quarter with penalty after penalty. The turnover certainly hurt. Philip Simmons has the first chance and a crack to put some distance on the scoreboard.
And when Dean says clean, it's both. It's hold on to the football. There was an indicator of the wet turf as it skips to Riley Beard, protecting it with a couple arms to the 33. It's about not only holding on to the football, but playing clean, penalty-free football.
Again, Philip Simmons, last drive of the second quarter, weren't able to get points. They did a nice job of moving the ball.
Isaac Schimpf in the primary ball carrier. He's back there. Split next to Tripp Williams. Also with him was Sherrod Williams. They're both just blocking for Tripp Williams. He's got about four.
Williams with one of the turnovers on a very similar play as he was fighting for yardage. So we have a little mini drone hanging over the midfield. Looks like a stationary bat.
Had bats in our eaves a couple weeks ago.
I saw that.
It's fun times.
I believe it's your bats in your belfry.
Similar looking play. Couple of backs blocking for Tripp Williams. It's a first down. About 6 yards for him. First down brought to you by Millermont College, proudly supporting Lowcountry's high school sports.
Tripp Williams built for this kind of game. He's got the ability to tuck and run. Strong, physical kid.
Eric Bendick told me he can probably play either college football or baseball if he decides which to pursue. He gives it to Sherrod Williams. First carry for the sophomore tonight. Just the sixth of the season. Gets him out to midfield and a gain of four on the stop. It was Ashton Guidi.
All you need to know about Trip Williams' mentality is he's a catcher.
Tough. Doesn't mind getting dirty. Probably has a pretty good arm, which we've seen.
I'd like to see him throw one. I'd like to see him zip one. Most of his throws tonight have had a lot of air underneath them.
Kind of like that one. Out to Schimpf. He leads him. Schimpf breaks the first tackle and is close to a first down. He's out of bounds at the 44.5.
Andrew Taws had him at about the 48-yard line. Taws is the second leading tackler on this team, coming in with 31.
I think there's a decision whether to give the first down or to measure. Second time we've had that, or they're not measuring. They're not giving the first down.
I'm not sure the ball could be any further away from the sticks, by the way.
K.J. Asbury takes care of that. It's a first down on third and inches. Stop made by Jack Mullen. First down brought to you by Miller Mott College, proudly supporting the Lowcountry's high school sports. Bishop England looking for its first win of the year. They had to have a quarterback tryout prior to last week's game against James Island, and they were within a point in the fourth quarter before a late score. Williams took his eyes off the ball, then he locates it to fall on it.
I've seen a lot of things in my day. I've never seen this. There's the battle of the iPhone lights. If you take a look at the Bishop England side, I'm not sure if they're trying to blind each other or who's got the better phone.
Well, if we turn out the stadium lights, then maybe we can figure out who has the more powerful sideline phones.
Back in the day at concerts, it was a simple Bic lighter.
Yes. Even at concerts now, it's gone to the iPhone light. So I've heard. I haven't been in forever. Second down and 12 on the edge, but behind Riley Beard.
That's the kind of ball where he needed to step in and just whip it across the field. He was on the far hash going across. He had Beard open. Beard had some room to move, but by the time the ball lofted over, there was pursuit, and it was an incompletion.
I will give a lot of credit to this Philip Simmons student section. They've been in it and packed from the get-go. They've been standing,
they've been good.
The whole game.
I'm not sure what the road theme is with the traffic jerseys. Again, right there, zip it.
Stevenson, he's got zips in his legs, but that play took too long to develop.
And I think that's what the offensive coordinator just motioned to him. He's like, throw it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if Coach Bendig has gone the way of the PC coach and just decided not to punt. But this is about the third or fourth consecutive fourth down that they've gone for.
Did you see the numbers PC put up last week?
I know, but they played St. Andrews.
I know. But the numbers jump off the page. They won't be that way again. Fourth down and 9. Williams to the end zone. It's caught. Touchdown, Philip Simmons. Second touchdown of the day for Tristan Skipper. He's got a defensive touchdown and now one from deep.
The only reason that works for Tripper and Skipper, it's because Skipper positioned himself almost as a rebounder. He's able to stay in front of the defender. He gets the defender on his back hip pocket and simply just blocks him out. I wouldn't say the BE defender made a bad play on it. Ajobi was there.
just boxed out, like you said. Touchdown to Skipper makes it 21-12. 21 unanswered for the Iron Horses. On a Trident Technical College touchdown, your future, your college.
Carolina Aesthetic Plastic Surgery Institute has highly experienced, friendly staff that are dedicated to helping you look and feel your very best. Performing at the local hospitals in the surrounding Mount Pleasant area, Dr. Thomas Hobb provides comprehensive plastic reconstructive surgery as well as non-surgical cosmetic surgery for the face and body. If you have any questions about your next procedure or looking to schedule your next appointment, get in contact with our experienced team and we're more than happy to help. Call 843-884-1400 today. Visit us at CarolinaCosmeticSurgery.com. Fans, I mean, told to remind everyone in the stands to make sure you keep everything clean as you cheer for the Iron Horses. Fans, please make sure that you stay on your respective sides of the field. That's for both teams.
On maybe an unseasonably cool night, one of the hotter things going for the Iron Horse program is Tristan Skipper. A 75-yard scoop and score that changed the momentum in this game and made it 12-7 Bishop England. And then he caps off what's been 21 straight for the Iron Horses with a touchdown reception, his first of the year. Good night for Skipper, potentially a good night for the Iron Horses, who have never won four games in a year and have never beaten Bishop England. They're a quarter and a half from both of those goals. I think it was the first time Peterson's been back there on kick return today, but he doesn't get the ball. Instead, it's Chase Daniel. And that was...
I'm going to get a little verbal chipsation.
Chipsation? Okay.
I said verbally chippy last week. I didn't like it.
Well, trickeration became a word.
It did.
So, chipsation.
Just get a little chippy.
Yeah.
Just talking back and forth.
I'll contact Webster's, see if that can be added.
It's not.
Okay. First and 10 for Finlayson and company. This has been consistent as well. Weston Peterson for 9 more yards, and Peterson gets to the third level. Michael Spignardo eventually with the stop. We got a couple Philip Simmons players down in the backfield.
Looks like 7 went down with a Woj tick. Looked like he was cramping. Finlayson almost looked like he was going to help him stretch it out before he walked away.
It's almost like the two...
That's Rainey, too.
It is.
That's their top two tacklers.
Almost like Rainey is reaching out, trying to hold his hand, not...
I mean, you can see his calf bulging. I'm not saying he doesn't have bulging calves to begin with. And I hate to, like, spring another genius moment on you, but this is a huge drive for BE.
It is. And it started off perfectly. The only way it could have been better is if they marked him. Well, now they've changed their minds. The down marker on the field had second down. And in the time it took for both those cramps to alleviate enough for the players to walk off, they've moved the chains.
You're saying the chain gang's having a rough night.
They've had better.
But the weather's perfect.
The weather is great.
Missing their top two tacklers here. Let's see if they go back to the run and try to punish the middle of that Iron Horse defense.
Here's Weston Peterson. He goes right at the teeth of that defense and is stopped there at the line of scrimmage. That's Josh Gantz, a sophomore linebacker.
Wojtek stays on the bench. On the other, about 30 yards away, is Rainey.
Farnwell, the motion man. Peterson straight up the gut again. First time we get to call the name of the freshman 32, Devontae McNeil. First guy into the backfield there. He's 6'1", 200. Bendick thinks he's got a strong, bright future ahead of him. He said he was too good to keep the freshman off the field. They picked up 10 yards on their first play. Now it's third and 10.
Four receiver set.
Pressure right at Finlayson. That affected his throw. Devontae McNeil was one of the two coming right in the face of Finlayson.
Nice job by McNeil. Two subs. Clamping down, forcing the punt. Iron Horse on a 21-0 run right now.
Last time Poole kicked it, he ripped one. This one wobbles a bit more, had a little bit more height, and takes a sideways bounce.
Riley Beard runs to the opposite side of the field. You only got to tell him once.
Earlier in the game, if you missed it, Beard made a decision he'd like back. Yes. Didn't work out.
But it was a teaching moment. It was a teaching moment.
And clearly, the lesson learned.
Yeah. That's why we're here, right?
Just inside the halfway point of the third quarter on QFS Transportation, Friday Night Rivals, driven by Cruise Chevrolet.
First drive of the third quarter, they went heavy, Trip Williams.
False start.
False start with play.
They went a lot with Williams, a couple of runs. Then they kept that drive with a long touchdown strike to Skipper. It was about 40 yards. And here's Schimpf.
Exact play they ran on the false start. Feels like that clock is running slow.
And it feels as though the right now for Philip Simmons, not trying to do anything too fancy. If you can pound it around, keep the clock moving. Bishop England hasn't shown the ability to sustain drives since the first quarter. They like this a lot, getting their guys out into the flats. This is Beard. And he gets a yard back from the initial line of scrimmage.
Williams a little better putting that on a line. Give his receiver a little bit more time to do something once he brings the ball in.
Pass complete out to the 30-yard line. That'll bring a third down.
It's interesting, they had a four receiver set, the play's called in. Williams goes into the offensive line to tell him.
Fires here for Stevenson, and Stevenson shakes off the first hit, which wasn't anything to just sniff at from Jack Huey, and moves the chains.
Well thrown ball by Williams.
Miller-Mott College first down, proudly supporting the Lowcountry's high school sports. Eric Bendig told me he's got a veteran offensive line, a veteran quarterback, and championship teams that he's around have had qualities that this team has. Leadership.
From your quarterback. Right.
And overall, and a buy-in that these guys, according to their coach, have.
We're in a counter play to Shrimp. Looks like it's going to be another offsides. Well, you've got a four-year quarterback. That goes a long way. And again, those lumps they took their freshman year, their sophomore year, not as much as last year. This is one of the. This is when they want to repay them, right? And it starts with BE 3-0, 0-3 against them, the first 3 years. There you
Stevenson
go.
Breaks off that route, cuts it back to the inside, and is still on his feet. Pirouetting using his hand as almost a tripod. Finally down by Charlie Rainey. That's a lot of work. Got about 9 yards.
Andrew Toss comes up holding his right arm, the shoulder region. They've only got 10 guys on the field right now. 36. Taking it back. They got 11. One of their leading tacklers.
Second down and 5. Schimpf rips it away from Williams and runs into a tag team. Marcus Malden, 31, leads the tacklers and brings up third down.
We've got a senior quarterback that found some rhythm through the air for the first time tonight. Not so sure I wouldn't let him just keep on slinging it. As long as the BE defenders are going to play 6-7 yards off the line of scrimmage.
We started this quarter out talking about no turnovers, be clean.
Yep.
This is the third drive of the quarter, which is almost over. There have been penalties, but a lot of the other stuff has been cleaned up. Here's Schimpf. Nothing fancy, straight ahead, should be a first down. Another Miller-Mott College first down.
Great acceleration into that hole, so once he made contact, he was still able to pick up an extra yard or so for the first down. Redesigning women up here in the press box. Designing women, by the way, one of the classic sitcoms of all time.
So the problem is, as you get older, your typical habits of wanting the highest chair possible to call
yes,
a game,
yeah.
If the chair doesn't have a back, as you get older, your back breaks, and you need to readjust.
Great throw.
Williams adjusts to the downfield route, but he drifts Q Greens out of bounds.
What he did really well on that throw is he looked the safety off to the left and then came back and has found his receiver. And that's almost a throw where if he puts that thing on a line, because he's got him beat.
Mm-hmm.
And the ball just drifts out of bounds.
And you reduce the risk of that ball sailing on you, drifting a little, as we said.
Right.
If you put a little more zip to it.
I'd rather put it out along the numbers and let him go run to it.
Second carry of the night for Sherrod Williams, and it comes with a lot of space. Slips through the second wave. Down the sideline he goes for a first down.
There was conversation before this year started that this would be the guy. They lost a lot of their returning, or lost all their running backs.
Mm-hmm.
But this was the conversation that this would be the kid, the sophomore.
Yeah, remember last year we did this game, Bishop England, Philip Simmons. It was a 14-7 game, and Peyton Woolridge showed out in that
game.
That's
right.
And we learned he was the cousin of a former Bishop England. I want to say D'Angelo Stevenson. Is that the right name?
Yep.
Here's Schimpf. Oof. Couldn't stretch it to the outside, chased by Jack Mullen.
Great play by Mullen to peel off a block and then make the tackle. Listen, your lower back may not be able to handle a stool for 2.5 quarters, But boy, your memory is still sharp.
Luck.
No, good.
Luck. Philip Simmons players are holding up a four, which tells you they're not going to run a play in the final 15 seconds of the third quarter. They're ready to get to the fourth. They've got 21 unanswered points on the board, which also tells you they trailed this game 12-0 after a 3-0 start to the season. And they're 12 minutes away from winning a fourth game for the first time in program history on QFS Transportation Friday Night Rivals, driven by Cruise Chevrolet.
Fans Design Build Construction is a locally operated general contractor operating with one goal in mind, to deliver excellent value for customers who need a well-designed commercial building. From the start of each project, we are upfront and transparent about all costs, as our goal is to create an advocate and a customer for life. Design Build Construction specializes in designing and erecting pre-engineered metal buildings and is a distributor of Chief Buildings. Call us today at 843-851-1449 for all your contracting needs.
Fans, you have the right financial advisor to help you reach your goals. Ameriprise advisors can create a personalized goal-based plan to help you prepare for whatever life brings.
Hello from Cruise Chevrolet in North Charleston, joined by Mark Milroth right now. Year in, year out, the team, yourself, you're supporting high school football in our area. Why is that?
Well, Scotty, part of our fundamental tenet here, we support the Ronald McDonald House, we support high school football, we support a whole bunch of things in the community. Robert Cruise, our owner, is very committed to the Lowcountry and puts a lot of money and time into supporting various schools and charities.
When they come in here as a customer, what could this group help them out doing?
Oh, Scott, it's a great time right now in the automobile business here at Cruise Chevrolet. We have 120 pre-owned automobiles, probably the best selection of pre-owned cars here. We're getting in about 100 new vehicles a month. We're all selling them as quick as they get in. It's just a really terrific time.
There's only one thing left to say.
You've got a friend in the car business.
If anyone can give the Cruise Chevrolet tagline better than Ken French, it's Mark Milroth.
Yeah.
You've got a friend in the car business, Cruise Chevrolet on Rivers Avenue. Three possessions in the second half. This is the continuation of the third. It started at the Philip Simmons 27-yard line. This is about their 12th play.
They went heavy run in the first series. Now they've gone back to the pass.
Williams keeps this. Seemed to have some of the defense leaning the wrong way. Chip Carlson, number 8, the linebacker on the stop. Gain of 5.
I was going to tell you it's 4-down territory. I think it's 4-down territory anywhere on the field right now for Eric Bending.
Didn't really get a favorable spot, so he's at the 30 to set up what will be 3rd down and...
like maybe 6?
7, yeah. There's a different scoreboard and on the field. It is 3rd down. Schimpf hit at the line of scrimmage. Andrew Simmons, 54, is the one who spun him around.
Looks like it's
about a yard short.
I don't even know anymore. They're going to call it 4th down, I think. Yep.
And they will go for it.
I'm sending Doom right up the middle here, right over the pile.
Well, Philip Simmons will counter by pushing Trip Williams through that pile. And if you're sending Doom through the middle, someone's got to take him down. Yep. He's all the way down to the 14. That's a 20-yard run when they needed an inch.
That was a team effort from the get-go. Not one, not two, but three guys pushing him through. You lose leverage, and he's able to drive it down to the 13-yard line.
A&I Fire and Water Restoration, making your house home again after disaster strikes. Sure looked like there may have been some early movement. There's maybe a yard gained on the carry from Schimpf.
He just anticipated the snap.
Tell you, that line of scrimmage pushed forward again. Philip Simmons is winning the trenches very clearly on these last two plays. That shouldn't have been more than a yard.
Talked about that the outset. Expected a heavy run game. Bishop England on their only drive, only possession of the third quarter, not able to run the ball at all.
They picked up one first down and ran four offensive plays, then punted. It's the only time Bishop England has touched the ball this half. You'd almost think Eric Bendig went to an option school. I mean, this is to a T what a Wofford or a Citadel would like to do. Or a Navy on a bigger level. Air Force visiting Navy tomorrow, by the way.
It's always a good game. I was watching Coach Bendig have a conversation with the officials. He's had some squabbles tonight. He's been a bit unhappy, but...
He told our Amy Russo at the half that he wasn't very pleased. They went into the locker room with a halftime lead, but he wasn't pleased. Too many mistakes, too many penalties. They've cleaned that up. There have been a couple of false starts, a couple of them on this drive. In fact, the drive began on their first play and then on their first fresh set of downs with a false start.
I've got a great picture. Coach Bendig was at Wando High School in the year 2000. He was a shadow for me in the sports department. He sent me the picture of him posing next to our satellite truck.
Schimpf and the gang catches up.
They want a late hit out of bounds. He goes back having a conversation with him again. But he sent me the picture and I said, "That's awesome. I feel old." Didn't go into sports broadcasts. And he goes, "No, but I stayed in sports."
Win-win? Push?
Push. No win.
I've told coaches, by the way, there is a hold. So 10 yards from the spot against Philip Simmons here. I have told many college coaches in the last 20 years that they're crazy for becoming coaches. Because...
Why?
Things can flip so quickly, and all of a sudden you're out of a job, and then I look at myself.
Yeah.
Like, well, you're just as crazy to get into broadcasting. Sports, I guess, either way, whether you're an athlete, a coach, a broadcaster.
It's a passion-driven industry.
Yes, it is. Got to have at least a couple screws not fully tight to get into it.
Yeah, but you love the trajectory of this program, what he's done here.
There's a whistle.
Except
fortunately
for right
for
now,
Trip Williams.
He's like, I wonder if Iceberg's still looking for a weekend sports guy. Because Bendig might apply if we get one more penalty.
Right after I said they've cleaned up the penalties except for two false starts.
They
get a hold
the heck
of the
out
boom.
Of them, didn't you?
First time in over 2 years, maybe 3 years, that I have reached the end of a drive chart that I have 18 plays slotted on what I'm keeping notes on here. So there have been a couple penalties. This is about the 16th, 17th play of this drive.
And a second and a whole bunch. We got 25.
Yeah, I got to get inside the five for a first down. Just trying to get something here. Michael Murphy on the stop.
You're up nine. You just can't make a mistake here. Right? It's got to be Bishop Higgins. Got to have two possessions, two scores. Now you go back, see how they start working the clock here. I mean, you say, well, there's 8:20 left.
But Bishop England's touched it for five plays this half.
Correct.
Got to get inside the five for a first down. Williams, it's a jump ball, and Stevenson's fingertips graze it with Huey in coverage.
Huey does a nice job of working his body around and almost put himself in the position as a receiver. I mean, is that the play again to the end zone?
Part of me has been waiting for this tonight. As much as I've talked about a 6'5"
kicker.
Oh,
here we go.
Yeah.
You like the 43-yarder.
He's got a leg.
With the left foot,
yes,
by the way.
Yes, we've seen the leg. Can he hit from 43? Griffin Gore.
No.
I don't think he hit it cleanly.
I think it was a – maybe it was a snap. But it's like when – it's like in golf when you want to hit that shot so well and you just overswing and you yank it right into the trees.
To get a look at the Bishop England crowd, I want to thank Angela. I'm not sure of her last name, but Angela correcting
yep.
us. I brought up the story of Peyton Woolridge and D'Angelo Stevenson. I incorrectly said they were cousins, actually brothers. And we thank Angela for watching her Iron Horses, potentially her Battling Bishops as well, and for correcting us. Second possession of this entire half for Bishop England.
That's so funny. So she wrote, she retweeted her November 20th. She's like, at ABC News 14 and at Darren Goldwater, thanks for the shout-outs to our family last night. Listening to you guys discover D'Angelo and Peyton, her brothers, in the fourth quarter is like discovering Princess Leia and Luke are twins. That's awesome.
And Layson pulls it, throws high, and what an interception. What a pick from Connor White. The play of the day for the Iron Horse. Laying
going
out
to get
for
the
interception.
The belt goes to celebrate with the student section. Shows them a little love for showing up tonight in their road gear.
Well, as much as the first half felt even
yep.
with similar things that could cross each other out,
yep.
the second half has not. Bishop England has now run six offensive plays in this half, and they've given it back to the Iron Horses here.
And they're going to go deep off the turnover.
and never had a shot. It was Giovi in coverage.
Finlayson had Ranny across the middle. That's a seam route that he's hit before in this game. Just overshot him.
Three wins last year, three wins in 19, two wins in 2018. A win tonight, and the Iron Horses are 4-0. They stretch went out with Williams, and he'll pick up two. Cruise Chevrolet, drive of the game. Cruise Chevrolet on Rivers, you got a friend in the car business. The drive of the game should have been the last one that didn't result in points because it took up basically the entire game.
Yeah,
but instead, it's the interception from Hunter Ramey. And that set up what was the second of two and then three consecutive scores for Philip Simmons on the Williams touchdown run. Williams has now accounted for 9 touchdowns on the year, 5 on the ground and 5 through the air. Your Cruise Chevy drive of the game.
Manny wanted that touchdown. He saw the end zone.
Gazing at the end zone again. Instead comes underneath for Beard. And it brings up fourth down.
All of a sudden, it's a series of stumble trip, stumble trip, stumble trip.
I think part of the play calling in that sequence of putting it in the air was knowing Eric Bendig that this was 4-down territory anyway.
I like the first call. I like to call him first down.
Pressure coming from Murphy, who rides him down to the ground. Check it, Jack Mullen. And a turnover on downs will give Bishop England the ball back.
It just doesn't make sense to me. I mean, it's a 9-point game. And it was fourth and long. You're going to give him 30 yards. Right? That to me, that's a win for Bishop England. Right? You pick up plus 30 instead of punting the ball down to the 10 or wherever.
Limerick Heating and Air, cool play of the game. Call today, comfortable tonight. Your cool play is the game-changing, momentum-changing play from Mr. Tristan Skipper. First of two touchdowns of the night for Tristan Skipper. Your Limerick Heating and Air, cool play of the game. His other touchdown was a receiving touchdown. That ball.
They're going to call him down.
It was down, yes.
The side judge. It just was great pursuit. Never allowed the pitch to develop. Now BE finds itself in a hole.
A hole of 19 on second down. They will try Peterson through the middle, and there wasn't a whole lot there for Peterson in the middle.
Wojtek off the deck with a cramp, off the bench with a cramp, make a nice stick with 6 minutes left.
And Bryce Smalls with the stop.
They never could find the rhythm after that first defensive touchdown by Philip Simmons.
After our Limerick Heating and Air cool play of the game.
It was a cool play for sure.
Especially for Philip Simmons.
Eric
he wants the false start. Instead, he's going to have the encroachment on his team. Bryce Smalls, who made the stop on the last play.
Smalls been great all season. Just jumped the count by the blink of an eye.
Third down and 14. They need midfield for a first down. They try a screen here to Peterson. And Peterson got some of his shoelaces caught. He's down at the 45 with another flag.
That's a push in the back. Spignardo pleading his case. The jury had already reached the verdict. That foul came about the 35. Also a time maybe to...
Player of the game is sponsored by Reliable Equipment, and some of the shots of the game should be sponsored by Reliable Equipment as well. Our end zone scissor lift provided by Reliable Equipment. We rent the good stuff. So if you want the good stuff, Reliable Equipment is who you call.
I'd like to have that in my driveway.
I could dunk if I had that, positioned appropriately by the rim. On the move, underneath, Rainey. Chopped down 10 yards shy of a first down, so it'll be fourth down here for the Bishops with 5 minutes to go in the game.
And with 5 minutes left, BE with the ball tonight. We keep our thoughts and prayers with Paul Rooney, longtime athletic director, basketball coach over at Bishop England, in the hospital battling COVID right now. Not a finer gentleman you will run across in covering sports throughout the Lowcountry in the last 30 years than Paul Rooney. Battle like a bishop. Battle like a bishop.
I know those sentiments are echoed by everyone associated with Bishop England now and through the years. And a lot of others around the Lowcountry. I mean, his reach is well beyond the walls of Bishop England. So get well, coach.
That is a small fraternity. Tight fraternity. Coaches and athletic directors.
Riley Beard instructing the rest of the Iron Horses to stay away from that punt. And Philip Simmons will take over. Time for our Reliable Equipment Player of the Game. Remember, they rent the good stuff. I think Skipper's a good pick for the Player of the Game. He's got a pick six that completely, or a scoop score six that completely changed the game. And then a touchdown reception as well. So he had the first touchdown and the most recent touchdown.
By the way, that is the catcher throwing to the pitcher. Both All-State players. Trip to Skipper. Flag comes down.
The way now, the flags have been thrown, a lot of these guys could be pitchers.
If we're to assume that this lead is going to hold, and Philip Simmons moves to 4-0, this is what they look like from here on out. Hanahan next weekend.
Mm-hmm.
A different kind of Hanahan team with Art Craig at the helm.
And a freshman quarterback that can apparently sling it as well.
And then they have Burke. And Lake Marion Burke did not play today. That was a late cancellation. That was like a 5 o'clock cancellation
today. Yeah.
Today. And then Lake Marion, conference games, Woodland, Timberland, and Ridgeland-Hardeeville. There could be 7 wins on that schedule, if not 8.
And Timberland, Woodland, second and third to last games of the year, so time to get improvement under your belt. Before you get to, traditionally, 2 of the strongest teams in this region.
And that is to assume that we play the games.
Yes.
I think I just saw...
This is a Bishop England timeout.
Stratford and... I'm not going to say it. But there was a schedule change for next weekend. We will be at Johnson Haygood.
Yes. For Buford and Oceanside. And our first look at Joe Call's group. Bunch of college prospects on that Oceanside team.
Rob Gant is tweeting out that Goose Creek and Stratford will meet next week at Goose Creek High School instead of later in the season. Stratford barely beat Hanahan tonight, 15-14. 2-point conversion in overtime, the difference.
Whew. Denny McDaniel gets it done. Second down for Schimpf, who hurdles the pile and will be spotted at the 36-yard line in another timeout.
This is what is will be impressive as the season goes on. Philip Simmons can feature literally four running backs.
Yes.
Right?
We've seen three of them.
You've got
the
three running backs.
And then Tripp.
And then Tripp is your fourth. And they could just, they could grind out any game they wanted, especially with this offensive line.
We've seen it tonight. The drive that took up the entire half that didn't result in any points.
Right.
But it's...
But it featured all three of the running backs.
It did. And early in the game, there were a couple of handoffs, one to Stevenson and another to Q Greens, two receivers.
Right. You've got Asbury and then Sherrod, the sophomore.
And Schimpf, untouched until he gets a first down and then spun down at that point. That'll move the chains and start putting hammer to nail here in what could be the first win for the Iron Horses over the Battling Bishops.
Bishop's schedule doesn't get easier. They play Timberland next week and then OCA. And then they go Magnet, Battery Creek, North Charleston and finish up with Hanahan. Now he's going to let the clock go to about 10 before he snaps it down to about 6.
Here's Schimpf, one of the strongest players on the team, according to Eric Bendig, only a sophomore as well. Marcus Malden with the stop.
You talk about some of the numbers, and this is how you really want it. So this team features three freshmen, 18 sophomores, 18 juniors, and 12 seniors. And we've talked about a lot of sophomores and juniors tonight.
Yeah.
And that's how you build a program by the numbers.
And a lot of the skill guys are those sophomores. The seniors are largely on the lines. So you got the veteran offensive line, then you got the skill guys like the sophomore Schimpf here. And you can tell how much they're wearing down Bishop England. He's getting plenty of yards before he's even touched.
But I will tell you this, as I've been keeping an eye, Bishops keep coming at him.
Uh-huh. That's something.
And again, you take a look at the time of possession, the number of plays, right? To keep them at 21 has been impressive.
This defense has been on the field this entire second half. With the exception of, what, 7 plays, 10 plays?
Yeah.
But it's a staple. You know you're going to get that when you're playing BE. I mean, you know they're going to keep coming, regardless of the circumstances.
Right.
Philip Simmons is a first down away from icing this game with a minute 45 to go, and they're 2 yards away from that first down.
And there's the first down.
It'll be a 4-0 start for Philip Simmons, the first time Philip Simmons has ever won 4 games in a single year. And they've done it this year without losing a single one of them.
Now, if you take a look at about the 50-yard line, I'm not quite sure. We've seen Gatorade baths before. It looks like they're going to give Bendig a water bottle bath.
It's a good call. There isn't the Gatorade bottles out there anymore, right? Everyone's got their own water bottle. The coaches were visibly enthused about that first down that they just got.
Yeah.
It was a... we did it type of look from up here.
Keep an eye on about the 45-yard line. Take a wide shot. The covert operation is not great right now, but certainly something to celebrate for one night, right? That's all they get. They get this one night.
And they should enjoy it, man. It's the fourth year of this program. They're starting 4-0. They're beating Bishop England for the first time in program history. Bendick said it himself, if you want a rivalry, you got to win sometimes. Put them in the win column.
Let's see what the reaction will be. 41 seconds on the clock.
They do have to snap it one more time. The offense controlled this game in the second half. They were on the field all night long. 21 unanswered for Bendig and company, and there's your water bottle bath.
Some of you may know, may not know. Eric Bendig was super close with Wando's Bob Hayes. Bob was the best man in his wedding. Godchildren to his child. Passed away, seems like yesterday. But as he starts to turn this program around, using many of the lessons that he learned from Coach Hayes, his mentor, a special night like this when you win the fourth in year four, in the fourth game of the year.
I was having a conversation recently about the Bob Hayes high school coaching tree and how impressive it is. Toss Bendig's name onto the list. Fourth year, they've surged into the top 10 in the 2A rankings. And now they've surged to a 4-0 start on QFS Transportation Friday Night Rivals, driven by Cruise Chevrolet. Philip Simmons wins it on the field, but our rock star cheer of the night, Bishop England won. Look, that's close. That's really close. Normally the road team wins by a landslide margin. Bishop England wins our rock star cheer of the night. It is time for our QFS Transportation Trophy presentation. QFS Transportation, empowering our drivers and trucking agents to succeed, is our number one priority. And Eric Bendig is empowering his program to succeed. That's what they've done. A 4-0 start for Eric Bendig.
To the front. Yeah. Let's go ahead. And Tristan, we'll go ahead and give you the Friday Night Rivals trophy to hold.
Yeah.
So, coach, fourth game. of the season this year, and it's the fourth year of this program. Kind of tell me, how did you keep that momentum going this game?
We just had a bunch of great kids that believe in what we do, and they worked their tails off to be here. I couldn't be more proud to be the head coach of this program. They just believe in us.
And how do you keep that going throughout the rest of the season as well?
They know we're going to work hard on Monday. We're going to enjoy it this weekend. We got to hydrate a little better. Go right out there and try to beat the Hawks next week on Friday.
All right, well, you guys enjoy the rest of your night. Congratulations.
Building programs. A lot of new milestones to notch. Get a QFS trophy presentation to go along with their fourth win and a 4-0 start and their first ever win over Bishop England. That's going to wrap things up here from Philip Simmons. Iron Horses knock off Bishop England 21-12. They score the last 21 points of the game to do it. Next week, Beaufort at Oceanside. Thanks so much to all of our sponsors for making QFS Transportation Friday Night Rivals driven by Cruise Chevrolet possible each and every week. We couldn't do it without you. Stay tuned at 11 for QFS Transportation Friday Night Rivals on ABC News.